Thanks for joining us on the CBN News Channel. I'm Charlene Israel.
And I'm Ephraim Graham. The abortion battle is back in Texas after a bruising defeat just 2 weeks ago. Texas Republicans are trying again to pass restrictions on late-term abortion, this time in a special session. Thousands of activists on both sides of the debate are flooding the Texas Capitol.
The nation's eyes are focused on Texas as the abortion debate comes back to life this week. Thousands of protesters are outside the Capitol. Pro-life supporters wearing blue, pro-choice supporters wearing orange. Texas Republicans are determined to pass the tough new abortion restrictions they failed to approve last month.
This is going to pass. Peaceful, diligence, persistence, patience.
A House vote is scheduled for today, but first, legislators will spend hours debating the measure. If it passes, the bill would ban most abortions after 20 weeks of pregnancy, citing the belief that unborn babies can feel pain by that stage. The measure would also require abortion clinics and abortion doctors to comply with the same standards as the rest of the medical field. Critics say the bill would shut down most of the abortion clinics in Texas.
We think it's bad for the state of Texas to be waging this kind of fight against the women of this state, but we will fight it.
The initial House bill failed after Democrat Senator Wendy Davis filibustered for nearly 10 hours. And then, unruly protesters continued to run out the clock.
People have relayed to me that never in the history of Texas have they seen that type of a mob rule come in and discombobulate a legislative session.
Governor Rick Perry called a special session so lawmakers could take up the measure again. This time around, fevers continue running high. Last week, this video emerged of anti-abortion protesters singing Amazing Grace as abortion rights activists chanted back, "Hail Satan." Governor Perry vows that this time the bill will pass.
Texas is a place where we defend life. I mean, that's the powerful message here, and that's what we're focused on.
This could be his last chance to push the measure through. Perry announced yesterday that he will not seek a fourth term in office.
A poll conducted by the University of Texas and the Texas Tribune found 62% of Texas residents support a ban on late-term abortions.
A federal judge has granted a temporary restraining order preventing Wisconsin from enforcing a new abortion law. The law bans doctors from performing abortions if they don't have admitting privileges at nearby hospitals. U.S. District Judge William Conley granted the hold Monday in response to a Planned Parenthood lawsuit. The abortion provider argues the requirement would unconstitutionally restrict the availability of abortions in the state. Proponents say the law was aimed at providing the best available health care for women.
The U.S. government will not stop sending military aid to Egypt for the overthrow of President Mohamed Morsi. U.S. law requires non-humanitarian aid be cut off in the event of a military coup, but the Obama administration is signaling it will continue to work with Egypt's interim government. Some members of Congress want to withhold $1.6 billion in U.S. aid if a civilian government isn't restored soon.
Egypt's top Muslim cleric warns the country is on the brink of civil war. He's calling for the bloodshed in the streets to stop. This after 50 people died in clashes between Egypt's security forces and supporters of the ousted President Mohamed Morsi. Both sides in the conflict are blaming the other for starting it. Chris Mitchell reports from Cairo.
The military video shows some members firing on the soldiers.
We were assigned to secure the Republican Guard headquarters. And suddenly, early morning, we found motorcyclists firing at us, and some of us were hurt.
But the Muslim Brotherhood says the army planned the assault to break up their protest to reinstate Mohamed Morsi, and said they'd launch an intifada in response to the violence.
Whatever happened in Monday's clashes, some fear it might be just the first of many between the army and the Muslim Brotherhood. It's unlikely that Mohamed Morsi will ever be reinstated, and the Muslim Brotherhood will not give up its goals. But for most Egyptians, after just 1 year of rule under the Muslim Brotherhood, they saw a different future.
They saw a black future, I believe so. They saw the future of Afghanistan. They saw the future of Pakistan.
Freddie Benjamin is a leader in the Egyptian Social Democratic Party. He says the Muslim Brotherhood has its own agenda.
The Muslim Brotherhood, mainly, they are based on a very solid rock ideology, which is building the Islamic Caliphate. Okay? This is their main strategy and main target. It will never change. The tactics may change to achieve this goal, but the strategy will never change. They are intolerant. They only use democracy to kill democracy.
The Muslim Brotherhood began in 1928 and spawned most of today's major terror groups, including Al-Qaeda and Hamas. Benjamin says just one-year rule under the Muslim Brotherhood sent 33 million Egyptians to the streets on June 30th, the biggest political protest in human history. He says that's why they want to send a message to the Obama administration, who they believe has supported the Muslim Brotherhood.
That brother Muslims are completely against democracy. They are against human rights, women's rights. They don't believe in freedom of speech, freedom of belief, freedom of religion. They don't believe in all this. That's what I want. That's what many Egyptian people want to convey this message to Obama administration.
Many Egyptians feel the overthrow of the Muslim Brotherhood is a key part of the global war on terror. Meanwhile, the White House says it will not cut off aid to Egypt. And here in Egypt, the interim government says new elections are planned for next year. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Cairo, Egypt.
Here at home, immigration reform tops the list for Congress as it goes back to work this week. House leaders are not happy with the Senate bill, which they believe favors amnesty over border security. As John Waggie explains, the bill has divided Republicans.
The bill, as amended, is passed.
Many House GOP members don't like the new Senate immigration bill, passed with the help of Republicans. And on the Sunday talk shows, they used the word concern more than once.
But my concern with the Senate bill is that they put the legalization of 11 million people ahead of security. The legalization happens first, and then the security happens second. And I think the American people are not going to stand for that.
Arizona Senator John McCain is one of the so-called Gang of Eight Republican and Democratic senators who wrote the immigration bill. He says the Senate is ready to work with the House.
And I believe that if they can come up with a bill, we would be more than eager to negotiate with them. A failure to act is de facto amnesty for 11 million people living in the shadows. I think wherever you are on that issue, there's agreement on that. So then shouldn't we sit down together and solve this this issue, not only for the good of the Republican Party, but for the good of the nation?
But a large number of House Republicans are not willing to hand Democrats a political victory while passing what they see as a bad law. House Homeland Security Committee Chairman Michael McCaul also used that word, concerned.
I'm deeply concerned that the effort should be bipartisan. Border security on my committee was unanimously approved, completely bipartisan bill. My concern is that the political backdrop could be that the White House would like to see this fail in the House, so that he can blame the House of Representatives for that and then try to take back the House of Representatives, and then all bets are off on his agenda.
House members heard from their constituents over the 4th of July break and will meet privately Wednesday to determine their strategy. Leaders say it may be at least September before lawmakers take final action. John Waggie, CBN News.
New revelations today about the National Security Agency programs that spy on our internet activity. NSA leaker Edward Snowden says tech companies in the U.S. have given the government full access to all our online communications. The NSA has claimed it only targets foreign traffic, but Snowden told the Guardian newspaper that's not true.
The NSA doesn't limit itself to foreign intelligence. It collects all communications that transit the United States. Companies like Google, Facebook, Apple, Microsoft, they all get together with the NSA and provide the NSA direct access to the back ends of all of the systems you use to communicate, to store data, to put things in the cloud, and even just to send birthday wishes and keep a record of your life.
Snowden is hiding from the U.S. government. Meanwhile, a congressional oversight board is holding a hearing today to investigate the NSA's secret surveillance.
The three women held captive in a Cleveland home for a decade are speaking out. In this YouTube video, Amanda Berry, Gina DeJesus, and Michelle Knight thank the public for their prayers, encouragement, and financial contributions to a fund set up to help them.
I want to thank everyone who has helped me and my family through this entire ordeal.
Everyone who has been there to support us has been a blessing.
I don't want to be consumed by hatred. With that being said, we need to take a leap of faith and know that God is in control. We have been hurt by people, but we need to rely on God as being the judge.
The young women also thank people for respecting their privacy and ask that they continue to do so. Former bus driver Ariel Castro is waiting to stand trial on a 329 indictment on charges of kidnapping and rape.
Coming up, a radical group that's trying to do in Nigeria what the Taliban has done in Afghanistan. Find out more about Boko Haram and why they have Nigerians living in fear.
Egyptian Christians are grieving the murder of a Coptic priest in northern Sinai. Islamic gunmen opened fire on a 39-year-old father, Minu Abdu Sharel, Saturday. The priest's murder came after Muslims Brotherhood supporters criticized Egypt's Coptic Orthodox Pope for backing the military's removal of President Mohamed Morsi. That happened from power on July 3rd. Christians fear they are being targeted for attacks, as many Morsi supporters blame them for the recent turn of events in the country.
Islamic militants attacked a school over the weekend in northeast Nigeria. At least 42 students and a teacher are dead in Yobe State. Survivors say the militants drenched a dormitory in fuel and then set it on fire. Authorities blame that violence on Boko Haram, a radical Muslim group that has been behind a series of other attacks in the region. The government ordered all secondary schools in Yobe State closed after that attack.
And with us now is CBN international correspondent George Thomas. He's been to Nigeria and seen firsthand the works of Boko Haram. So, George, tell us about this group.
Yeah. Well, it was founded back in 2001 as an indigenous local group based mainly up in the northern part of Nigeria. But then in 2009, it decided to go jihadist. And so they wanted to turn a particular state in the north, turn it into an Islamic emirate. The Nigerian military stepped in and basically crushed it. But it's the word Boko Haram is actually a Hausa word, which means Western education is sinful. And it's an Islamist organization that has reportedly ties to Al-Qaeda and other jihadist groups in the region.
So why attack a students at a secondary school?
Again, Ephraim, it goes back to this idea that they just do not believe that Western education, teaching kids how to use a computer, teaching kids math, English, science, they believe that Islamic Sharia law, which is the Islamic jurisprudence, the fundamental foundational tenets of Islam, should only be that that's taught in these schools. And so they think any education that is against or not part of Islam, it is forbidden and obviously should not be taught. And in fact, this is the third attack that's happened in the northern part of the country.
Unbelievable. But considering what you're saying, Christians, there must be a special target for this group, correct?
They have been, really. I mean, it's been horrific. In fact, 2012 was the deadliest a year for Christians all around the world. In Nigeria, close to about 900 Nigerian Christians were killed last year. No other country in the world has experienced such atrocities. And this year, it's getting worse, and the situation doesn't seem to be stopping.
So it's getting worse. What is the government doing to stop Boko Haram? We've seen the violence.
Yeah. There's been a lot of pressure on the Nigerian government. The president, about 2 months ago, May 12th, launched a military offensive up in the north to go after three particular states that really has become the epicenter of Boko Haram's operations. And so they sent in thousands of Nigerian troops into the region. The efforts to quell the attacks continues, but clearly, the attack on the school is another very, very sad reminder of how effective they continue to be.
Now, some have warned that there is a danger of civil war between the Christian South and Muslim North. What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, people need to realize that Africa, this is the most populous nation on the African continent. 170 million Nigerians who live here. And they, and the country is really broken up. If you look at the map of Nigeria, evenly split. The Muslims in the north, the Christians in the south. And most of the attacks have, over since 2009, focused mainly in the north. There have been, in the last 12 months, attacks in the southern part. But most of the attacks takes place in the north. And so they are clearly trying to get Christians in the south engaged and try to create a civil war. But the Christians, look, if you look at the northern part of Nigeria, primarily poor, a lot of corruption, a lot of mismanagement of government amongst the states in the north. The south is very rich, lots of oil, most of the oil. Again, Nigeria is one of the top oil producers in the world. And so there is this conflict between the northern part, poverty, southern part, Christian, and predominantly Christian, and lots of wealth.
No, real quickly, tell us about the Christians there. How are they enduring, and how can we pray for them?
Yeah, you know, it's such a sad situation, Ephraim. Just imagine every Sunday morning, you and I go to church. In the northern parts of Nigeria, every Christian who goes to church on a Sunday is not guaranteed that he or she will come back, because these attacks have been going on specifically against Christians and churches. And so it's a very, very sad situation, and we need to continue to pray.
Absolutely, indeed, indeed. George Thomas, as always, thank you so much for your insight.
You're welcome, sir.
Coming up, do you know what a food's bliss point is, or what's meant by the ultimate mouthfeel? An investigative reporter infiltrated America's largest processed food companies, and he spills their deadly secrets. Next.
When it comes to health, processed food has become public enemy number one.
That's right. Recently, health reporter Lori Johnson met an investigative journalist who went undercover to learn the secrets of the processed food industry and how they keep us hooked.
Processed foods, we know we should stay away from them, and those sugary drinks too, but they're just so hard to resist.
The food that we hate to love and that we're so tempted and will overeat is a problem, and the solution is gaining control over that food.
Michael Moss is a Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative journalist for the New York Times. He infiltrated America's largest processed food companies. In the book Salt, Sugar, Fat, he exposes how they addicted us.
They got big by making products that are utterly irresistible to people, both in taste, but also ultra convenient, that will sit on the shelf and be waiting for you when you're ready to eat them, and also incredibly low cost.
Maybe low cost at the checkout line, but we pay dearly later on with our health and lost productivity. Doctors trace our obesity epidemic back to processed foods, and so do the people making those products.
Startling thing is that the food industry itself has known for years and years that it's at least partly responsible for that.
Processed foods kill with staggering amounts of salt, sugar, usually high fructose corn syrup, and unhealthy fat.
I don't view the food industry as some evil empire that intentionally sought to make us obese or otherwise ill. The issue is kind of their collective zeal to do what companies do, which is to make as much money as possible by selling as much product as possible.
Inside these labs of the processed food companies, scientists use cutting-edge technology, formulating what's known as a food's bliss point, or its maximum flavor and allure. That usually means one thing: sugar.
Prepared pasta sauces on the shelf in the grocery store are really sweet. They will have as the equivalent of sugar, the equivalent of two Oreo cookies or more of sugar per tiny little half cup serving. I've started making my own pasta sauce, and it's not that hard.
They also lure us with texture. By manipulating a food's chemical structure, scientists achieve ultimate, what they call, mouthfeel. They also invented ways to disguise the sensation of being full.
Those chips will compel you to eat more and more beyond what you should, and you'll go back for more bags and more bags.
Processed food makers know we consumers care about nutrition. so they devise marketing schemes to make their products appear healthy. They'll dial back on one bad ingredient while secretly pumping up others.
So, for example, you can find a yogurt that sells itself as being low fat, but it can and often has as much sugar in it and calories as a serving of ice cream.
Labels tout healthy ingredients like calcium, olive oil, or fruit, but the amount of the good stuff is minuscule. A close look still shows shocking levels of salt, sugar, and fat.
The good news is we can resist the temptation to buy processed foods by coming to the store full, hydrated, and armed with a good shopping list. And don't buy anything unless it's on the list.
Spend more time on the perimeter of the store where you'll find the fresh foods. When you are in the center part of the store, be wary of the products at eye level. Grocers put those tasty, unhealthy items right in front of your face because they sell the most. So while processed food is delicious, cheap, and convenient, it could ruin your health. The extra effort to eat fresh food will likely pay off in the long run. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
And finally today, meet a pair of women who aren't afraid to take a risk when it comes to spreading the gospel.
That's right. Two Canadian women recently stepped way out of their comfort zone to raise support for Asian missionaries.
Jumping for Gospel for Asia to raise donations for bicycles.
Janine Jalbert and Danny Diaz of Ontario challenged friends to sponsor 100 bicycles for pastors in South Asia. Then they took a leap of faith. The two teachers boarded a small plane for their very first parachute jump. At 12,000 feet, they jumped with their instructors for a 50-second, 7,000-foot free fall at about 125 miles per hour. When they took their jump, the novice skydivers already had pledges for 73 bicycles. 6 minutes later, they were safely back on the ground, and by the end of the week, 16 more bicycles were funded. Gospel for Asia founder K.P. Yohannan said the donated bicycles will help pastors go farther, faster, and reach more people with the love of Christ. I love their enthusiasm and their fearlessness to do that.
Well worth the jump. Well worth it.
Well, that's going to do it for the CBN News Channel.
You can find more exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com. Have a terrific Tuesday, everybody.
Introducing the CBN Bible from CBN.com. Now, an easier way to study the Bible and grow in your faith. Highlight your favorite verse, read separate versions at a glance, click and read a commentary, or cross-reference your favorite verse using the Strong's Concordance. All the right tools to study the Bible, all in one place. The CBN Bible, available at cbn.com/Bible or the iTunes App Store.